Actually, I know you don't want this really, but till we get it some justice, we f***ing every city up. Drastic measures is urgent, the city burn like Philly blunts. Crazy like we jumping off a little yellow minibus. You for my people, cause you moving really sus. No, we ain't playing with them, really. Trust. You see them cities burning like chimneys, you better know it's really us. The clock was finally winding down, your time was really just. To feel the wrath of God, no matter how your door is really shut. Deep in my soul, injustice really cut. I'm only trying to be my people's clutch. Hypertension, I mentioned the temperature is different. What? This wouldn't have happened, now you witness blood. You must better listen up, cause now we out here fighting for what's right, like we don't give a f-.
And welcome the host of the local plug, my brothers Brent Van Wilder and the one and only Magic Baby.
You were tapped into the local plug. It's your boy Magic.
It's your man Brent Van Wilder.
I hope they heard all of that.
They did. I got you. Hit you with the point, hit you with the Elvis stance on them real quick. And we have a guest tonight. We have Miss Simone LeRae Poetry.
Hello, yeah. Hello.
Thanks for coming.
All the way from Greensboro.
So are you stationed in Greensboro? Well, I know you do a lot of work in Durham and Raleigh. So are you in Greensboro, or is it all your work just concentrated here in the Raleigh-Durham area?
We're mostly in the Raleigh-Durham area, but we're looking to expand everywhere. So we're going to be in Greensboro
soon. Gotcha. Now, when I first saw the Poetry Lounge, I thought it was an actual lounge. And that's not it, right?
Right, no. It is not an actual lounge. We just organize events for different bars, restaurants, and businesses, even if it's not a bar and restaurant, just different businesses that want a arts or entertainment avenue in their space, and we just bring it there.
Gotcha. And how long have you been doing this so far?
Believe it or not, only a year.
Just a year?
Just a year.
Not even a year yet.
Yeah, I've been busy. A year in January, so not even a year yet.
Yeah, you have been busy. Yeah, like I said, I've seen the posts. I've seen you in so many different places, and it was like, dang, where is the lounge? At one point, I was trying to find the lounge,
but I noticed it was a different place. So I'm glad you spoke on that.
Yeah, so, we bounce around everywhere, so the lounge is everywhere for now.
I like that. I mean, because it doesn't hold to just one place, and it gives people options, especially in Raleigh-Durham. I know a lot of times if it's something in Durham that people want to do, they'll take the ride, but they're reluctant for it. And the same thing in Raleigh, it's rare somebody from Durham come to Raleigh unless it's really, really something that they want to do.
Right.
So where do you find your most success at? Do you find it in Raleigh or do you find it in Durham?
Mostly in Durham, because I started in Durham, so a lot of my clientele comes from Durham, and Durham lacks the space. Raleigh has a lot of other open mics going on during the week, and Durham lacks the space, and so I get a lot more kickback in Durham.
Gotcha. And so how long have you been doing poetry altogether?
I've been writing poetry since I was 12, and so if I tell my age, I'm 33 now, so very long time.
Ain't that long.
That's not that long. I know, yeah.
Some older heads in here.
Kev?
I don't know who that is.
That's a dude out there. So it's one thing about poetry. Poetry, I used to be one of my favorite things. I used to watch, I don't know if you remember Def Poetry Jam.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah, that used to be one of my favorite shows. You ever used to look at that?
I caught it here and there. I wasn't that deep into it at that age.
No, Kanye before he was a rapper had poetry
before
bars.
Ye.
Tupac too.
Yeah.
Jill Scott, yeah.
That used to be my babysitter. Big shout out to Miss Jilly from Philly.
He loved to tell that story.
I love to tell that story.
Oh, like really?
Yeah. You see how he lit up?
Yeah. Oh, for real? Oh,
yeah. That was my babysitter. Yeah. Big. You know what? I'm not even gonna get into that. So, as far as performing, yo, you said that you're an introvert. So how does it work being a poet that's an introvert?
Introvert poet. My audience has learned to accept me for who I am. So I'm very soft spoken. I come up there with my phone. I would love to sit down, but I've tried to work on my standing stage skills a little bit better. But just very soft spoken. Just comforting with my phone, and that's how I share my poetry. But it depends on the day and what poem I'm reading. You might get a little bit of fire out of me depending on what I'm reading.
So we'll be able to hear a little something later on.
Yeah, I could read y'all something later.
Okay, got you.
Is it as therapeutic going up there and spitting what you wrote opposed to just writing it and keeping it to yourself?
As far as the therapy aspect of it, it's more therapeutic for me writing it and keeping it to myself. But I've found that when I'm up there and I read my pieces, especially my personal pieces to my personal story in life, it is very inspirational. And I've only read like personal pieces from my personal story maybe like two or three times on stage, because it's just a different category than people want to hear when you're out trying to have fun. And every time I do, it's very inspirational, and I always like reach a different type of person and audience when I share those personal pieces.
Okay. Let me ask you, what gave you the courage to get up and do this? Because speaking in front of people is, you know,
non-expert.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. So weird thing, a couple years ago when I first moved to Raleigh from Greensboro, there was this group called Stand Up, Speak Out, and they had a women's empowerment, like poetry slam at the Arts Museum. Okay. And I saw an ad for it, and so I sent my audition video in, and that was the very first time that I ever read a poem on stage. It was for domestic violence, women in abuse. It was the month of March, and I got on stage, and that was the first time I ever read a poem. And you had to, they gave you like a picture from the art museum that you had to write a poem based off of. Mm. And so I looked at the picture and I wrote my poem, and I was nervous, and I went there and I read it. But I got a lot of great feedback, and a lot of people just really received what I said. And I got to talk to a lot of performers, spoken word artists that were actually performers, that just encouraged me to like, hey, you're on stage now, so don't get off. And from then I just kind of been slowly doing open mics.
Hey, that's really dope. You got a question, bro? I saw you was about to say something.
Yeah, I was gonna say, did that inspire you to create your lane, like create that platform for other artists, for other poets?
Not in that moment. It wasn't born yet in that moment. So the Poetry Lounge didn't happen till maybe about a year and a half ago. The conversation actually came up on a date. And so it was a conversation I had on a date that ended up being manifested and coming to what you know it as today.
Really? Do you still date that person?
I do.
Oh, that's dope. That's dope right there. Now that's building.
It's the universe working.
That's the universe working for real, you know? So what was the enjoyment that you? Let me rephrase that. When did you see that that platform was going to be the platform that you was going to put your all into?
When did I see?
Yeah, when which show was it? What artist was it? What did you hear? Them like, you know what? I gotta keep doing this.
Honestly, it was the very first one. A very first show we had at Arcade of Thrones. Shout out to Arcade of Thrones for our first opportunity, but it was our very first show at Arcade of Thrones, and I ended up meeting this great group of poets called the Galaxy of Poets. And they're like all around. And they just kind of took me under their wing and just supported me. And I just got to see all the powerful poetry and how much emotion they put into it. And I just remember looking at some of them performing, and I was inspired, like, I want to be able to perform my poetry like that. And so that's when I knew that this was going to be a platform for those people. And since then, like, so many amazing people have come into the Poetry Lounge and offered, like, really great, really great poetry. If you went on my Instagram, you looked at some of the recap videos, like, we've had some really amazing poets. And so I always kind of knew that it was going to be bigger than what I imagined.
that's where the vision starts.
So it sounds like this all manifested through networking, which is something we've been talking about and we're really big on over here. So people listening, you know, reach out, network, join some groups. If you got a vision, somebody might help you get there.
Yeah, it's all about talking to the right people. But in order to talk to the right people, you just have to talk to people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you do. Can't be an introvert.
Well, and I wouldn't say you can't be an introvert. I would say you have to know when to be an introvert. Introverts are very observant people. That I know because I'm married an introvert. She sees. I'm an extrovert. I'm out there, and so I don't see what she sees. Like, so she's my eyes, and like I'm the mouth. I mean, whatever she sees, she little. So introverts are very observant, and it feels like you took the time to step back to see,
right?
To be able to, so you can be able to put the plan in motion, which is great. That's great resourcing more than anything. That's just great resourcing. So we're gonna get into some music again real quick. When we come back, we want to hear about some of your college, your Bennett experiences.
HBCU.
It's HBCU day. Big shout out to
them. Story for us?
You got a story for us?
A PG story?
I'll share a story with you.
Okay, cool. We like that. So you are plugged in too.
It's okay, bro. You can say
I don't want to tap. I don't want to tap in. I'm plugged in,
you
homie.
You tapped into the local plug.
We was just talking off air about just different events. I know we was going to talk about some HBCU experiences.
Yeah, but before we got to that, I know you said you get asked this question a lot, but I'm going to ask it again so the people can hear and maybe pick something up from it. What advice would you give somebody that is fearful in getting up on that stage and letting their words be heard? What kind of advice could you give them?
First advice I could give you, come on down to the Poetry Lounge. We support you. I've had a lot of first-timers come on our stage. Second advice is come as you are. Don't try to imitate what you see or what you think is cool. Come as you are. Be comfortable in your own zone and just do it. Because the first step is just getting that first word out or that first step or whatever. And once you're going, you can't stop. You have
once
to just
you start flowing, you flow. I think number one was the most important. Come out to
the Poetry Lounge. There you we go. Got you.
Yeah, you got to take that first step.
Uh-huh.
That first step. That with any performer, that first time on stage is always like, but as soon as you do it and then you get off the stage, you're like, yo, I did it.
You get that positive feedback.
I did it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It becomes almost addictive.
It does.
You're like, I got to do it again. I got to see where else it could take
it better.
So with the Poetry Lounge, like you said, Poetry Lounge is everywhere. It's not one specific spot. So I know you do different events. What are some of the events that you have coming up?
We actually got an event tomorrow, one of our popular ones, Throwback Gems and Karaoke. We got all the old school games from like the 90s, music from the 90s to the 2000s. We just play games, do different trivia. We call it the open mic party because we open up the doors just to karaoke and lip sync as well. So you can get up there and be Destiny's Child for a day, Jay-Z, whatever you want to do. We also have the comedians, poets that come out, and it's just kind of like a fun party with games and just having a good time. So we have that going on tomorrow. Next week, we got our comedians from the Ignorant as Fuck podcast coming out on the 28th. So you can check us out.
Yeah, hey, we're going to bleep that out. Yeah,
we bleep that. Don't worry about that.
Everybody does it. It's all good.
It's all good. Big shout out to Carter here in the mornings.
Hey,
the HF. So the event tomorrow, where is that going to be at?
That's going to be at the House Restaurant, Miami Boulevard in Durham.
Okay.
House Restaurant, Miami Boulevard in Durham.
Yeah. Right. Discount tickets are still available on Eventbrite, so you can get those still.
All right. You have any events going on in Raleigh?
Not this month. Vince and Raleigh are going to resume in January, so we have some pretty big announcements going on in January. So make sure you follow me, Simone Ray Poetry, or the Poetry Lounge for those updates.
Cool.
All right, that's on Instagram, right?
On Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, everywhere.
Everywhere. She got outside in the metaverse, y'all. Catch up.
Catch up. So what we were talking about was HBCUs, and you went to Bennett.
I did. I went to Bennett.
So you got some experience.
What's your Bennett experience like?
Well, Bennett is an all-girls school. So what I wanted to do when I went to Bennett is I wanted to focus on education by attending an all-girls school. And so when I got there, it's strongly based on sisterhood. They pair you with a big sister, and it just kind of gets you acclimated to, you know, just supporting women and being around women. And you went every Sunday to, like, this chapel, and you learned different things. We had Maya Angelou come to our school one time, which was great. And so it was just really focused on sisterhood. Had a lot of great experiences there. A&T, of course, right across the street.
Yeah.
So you really my lit. Logic in going to an all-girls school wasn't logical because you had A&T right there. So,
well, you know, Spelman's the same way. Spelman is right next door to Morehouse and Clark. Like, you got Spelman, Morehouse, Clark. And to me, I think the way that is unified is beautiful. Because you get a little bit of everything. You get your all girls, you get your all dudes, but then you get your co-ed. Mm-hmm. And they all intermingle. And when I noticed that about Bennett being right across the street from A&T, you still sort of get the same thing. You still get that, get the A&T feel. You get that co-ed feel, but...
You get to go home from it.
You get to go home from it. And I didn't know that that Bennett did programs like that for empowerment for women. Mm-hmm. I just thought, it's an all-girl school. That's just girls go there.
Yeah, that big sister setup is dope.
Yeah, because Peace used to be an all-girl school like that, but they didn't have programs where they paired women up with other older women. So I think, especially being an HBCU, Peace isn't, but Bennett being an HBCU, I think that's great opportunity and great networking for sisterhood and for women empowerment, which we need to see more of.
Right, exactly.
So with your poetry, I know poetry usually can take you to many different avenues. We was talking like seeing Miss Jill do poetry, then acclimate into music. Even my mom at one point was doing poetry, then acclimating into writing. What would you say your poetry would lead you into?
Right now, my poetry is leading me into a book coming out in March. Different avenues that I would like to explore. I would love my poetry to lead me into just kind of like a mellow performance type thing. I really want to bring back the old school jazz sensual vibes with just my poetry onto it. Because I actually used to be a singer before I did poetry. So I would kind of want to intertwine the two. Just bring back my own kind of mellow vibes with the poetry and music together.
That's dope. That's dope, yo. Had a band behind you. Don't fall, bro. It's on. Yo, I will laugh at you on air. Everybody will know. Magic fell. I'll say it just like that. He didn't fall.
So yeah, they can see. They can see. They see us. Yeah. We laugh.
Yeah, I know. So we didn't. So your craziest Bennett story.
PG Bennett story.
Craziest. I give you the funnest. The best Bennett story that I had was when we were waiting for Obama to be elected as president. We all stayed up real late in our dorm rooms. TV was on. And I remember when they made the announcement, we all just ran out in the hallways. And all you heard was that one song we all know, My President is Black.
Hey, my Lambo.
We ran outside, no shoes on. We ran over to A&T. People were in their cars. It was just a really good night, just celebrating our Black president. So that was one of my best.
I think we was lit all around HBCUs when that happened.
Yeah. Right. Everybody from Shaw went up to the Raleigh Capitol, and then all you see is Capitol Police surround the whole Capitol building, and you hear one person say, "Let's knock down a Confederate statue." That's how Shaw celebrated Obama being president. But I do have this question, not even questions, comment. You being from Maryland, why were you outside barefoot?
I mean, hey, my president was Black, so we could do whatever we wanted.
That went over my head, bro. I didn't even catch that.
I did, yeah.
I'm like, what you talking about, barefooted?
He was out there barefoot?
I mean, we was in our dorm room, so it was just the adrenaline.
She got acclimated to this
Southern culture. Like, yo, we don't need shoes.
Yeah.
What part of Maryland are you from?
I'm from Waldorf.
Oh, where?
Yeah, Charles County.
My old roommate was from there.
Where?
Waldorf? Yeah, yeah. I've been out there. It's real nice.
Yeah, all I know is Baltimore.
Oh, no.
Baltimore.
Baltimore is about an hour from, you know, where I'm from, so.
And you said, oh, no, like, oh, no.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, D.C. and Baltimore, two different separate sides, yeah. You know.
Yeah.
It's like Bloods and Crips, bro.
It is, yeah.
It's all love.
So as far as what you're doing with your poetry and the work that you're putting in to build this platform, would you consider doing mentorships for other young artists or young poets?
Absolutely. I actually would love to be a youth mentor. I had started a little small business years ago with my brother. I worked in an elementary school. That's actually one of my passions, mentoring the youth, but I would love to mentor. I actually have some ideas coming for next year that involves mentoring. So
yeah, that's a dope idea. Some words from the youth.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's dope.
No, it's nothing. Now, when I was younger, this is what I understand. When you have an adult show you a craft or skill and teach it to you, you're more inclined to want to learn more about that skill. It's sort of like when you're in the hood and you get a coach that really shows you the ins and outs of football and makes you want to really want to stick to football or basketball. Poetry is a sport. It's not a competitive sport, but it's something
it can be.
I mean, if you poetry battling, I've never seen a real poetry battle.
It ain't a poetry battle, but you can feel like, oh, you know, I feel like I'm better than this person, or I'm gonna go and, you know what I mean? You can make competition almost out of anything, bro.
I see that more in rap though. Poetry in itself is a shared experience. It's art. It's me sharing my art with you. Now rap, hip hop, I mean, that's a competitive sport. I gotta be the best MC. That's what they say. That's what Jay said. I gotta be the best MC out here. And I mean, with poets, like, yo, I just want to be heard, more so. So I think, but comparing it to sport, it still takes practice. It takes a coach. So hearing that you want to do some mentorship, that goes a long way, especially for youth who don't have mentors or can't find mentors or don't even know what their passion may be.
It's needed. I teach eighth grade language arts, and, you know, in most cases, I am my students' favorite teacher. And it's not because of the subject I teach or the books we're reading or what they're learning in class. It's just our relationships that we build with each other in the classroom. So mentoring is definitely in my future.
All right. So we're going to get into some more music. When we come back, you gonna give us some poetry?
Some bars?
Yeah,
some bars.
I'll give you a poem.
She said it like,
can we get a freestyle now?
I'm not about a freestyle.
Said
poem.
Said poem. Cool. We'll take them. You are plugged in too.
The local plug.
It's your man Brent Van Wilder.
It's your boy Magic.
And we are graced with the presence of Miss Simone LeRae Poetry.
Bars.
So before we got into the music, we asked for some bars.
Lord.
You got
a little poetry piece for us?
Yeah, I got some bars for y'all. Just call it a poem for now. So before I even read it, this is just one of my go-to poems. I wrote it towards the beginning of the new year. My focus word for the year is glow. And that's also glow. The title of this poem.
Big glow.
My glow is my resiliency to shine through darkness. My ability to find my way when I'm blinded by deception. My perception of me. My definition of me. When the world tries to taint me with labels not defined by my character. My ability to be me with no name tags. When the world tries to label me, fix me, medicate me, influence me to be other than who I am. I am molded by my imperfections, and I have no desires to correct them. It's a part of my glow. I'm built by my scars that made me resilient. I have no desire to cover them. It's a part of my glow. I find strength in my truth. It's a part of my story. I have no desire not to tell. It's a part of my glow. I find purpose in my poetry. It's a part of my healing. I have no desire not to write. It's a part of my glow. My ability to shine through bullshit. My ability to paint new words over lies. My ability to smile through tears. My ability to rise. Each time I glow for me. I glow for you. I glow for my mother who just couldn't make it. I glow for the child who just can't take it anymore. I paint my words with fireflies in the sky, and I hope that you read them. I hope that you see them. I hope you believe them when they tell you to glow. This world can't hold you anywhere for long. Emotions are only temporary. They fade in and out with happiness, sadness, anger, defeat, rotating, constantly giving you experience, purpose, and lessons. You were created never to fade or dim. Your skin gleams, your words beam brightly. You are lightning, stars, sun, and moon. And when God said, let there be light, he meant in you. Glow.
Bars. Or do we do that? You got snap, bro. Okay. That was dope. That was dope to me, because I feel like the glow is underestimated. Like, I wonder if, like, some females even understand that concept. Like, you literally have a glow. And you gotta let your
you gotta let your aura shine, yeah.
Yeah. You gotta
build your aura and let it shine out, yeah. let it be your light and your darkness. That was dope.
Thank you.
So we got the we got some poetry.
Ooh.
Got some bars out of it.
Hold on. You got something for us?
Who, me?
Yeah, you.
Let me see.
Never mind.
He about to be goofy, yo.
Hold on. City lights, city brights. Man, all these city nights had me up at night wondering, who all these crackheads gonna fight? Is it me? No, because I don't got what they want. These crackheads out here, they trying to flaunt with no teeth, no feet. What? How that crackhead gonna step to me? Bars.
Where'd you get that from, bro? Where did you get that?
He got that straight off the dome.
Freestyle. I saw the city. I was looking at that. Okay. It's inspired me.
Oh, that boy nice with it.
That boy good. Yeah, that was off the dome, off the Richter. So Simone, before we get out of here, we're about to close up the hour. Do you have any shout outs? Who you shout outs for?
You know, everybody that's a part of the Poetry Lounge family, I want to shout you out to the people that started with me, Tent Nation Gurus and Raleigh, 5-star window tinting. And Raleigh, go get your windows tinted, the galaxy of poets that supported me from day one. Stand Up Speak Out, first time I ever got on stage, just pretty much everybody. The House Restaurant, they got the best wings on earth. Go get your wings there.
Go get some.
I just want to thank you for all your support. Tune in, follow me, Simone Ray Poetry.
Cool. Wait, so that was your Instagram and Facebook?
Yeah, that's everything.
Instagram
everywhere.
And Facebook. It's everywhere.
Simone LeRae through the metaverse.
Google Simone LeRae Poetry. Yeah. It's everywhere.
You through the metaverse.
She's out here.
You swimming, dog?
Just Google me.
Gotta get through it. Through the metaverse.
Where? I dropped that. Well, we definitely want to thank you for coming out, showing us some support, blessing us with a poem.
Appreciate that glow.
We appreciate that glow. We appreciate your glow and what you offered us. We're definitely going to get you connected with Mr. Sean Ingram. Big shout out to him. One of my favorite poets. And we gonna build.
Make something happen.
We definitely appreciate you being part of the network, being part of the local plug here tonight.
Thank you. You're welcome for inviting me.
No doubt.